Hey guys, what's happening? Chris here. First of all, I want to give a shout out to Ritesh Batlani for suggesting that I make this video. If you have any requests like this, please let me know in the comment section below. Now let's dive in. Feedback loops are systems that can help balance your game and ensure it isn't unfair or that players don't feel the game drags too long and it just never ends. In today's video, I'm going to talk about the different types of feedback loops, what they are, and how they can make or break a game. First of all, I wanted to explain what a feedback loop is. A feedback loop is a system where the output feeds back into the system as an input. If you're still confused, bear with me. There are two types of feedback loops. There can be positive feedback loops and negative feedback loops. Positive feedback loops are systems that take positive play and reward it with more positive, or take negative play and reward it with more negative. One example for this is in Monopoly, where when a player can get money, that allows them to buy more property, which in turn allows them to get more money from those properties when other players land in their spaces. This will then allow the player to get even more money and so on. Another example of this is RPG games, where the player starts with really weak weapons. The player goes out to explore the world, and as they begin beating enemies, they will get experience and more money, which in turn makes them stronger. Therefore, they can beat stronger enemies to get even more money and even more rewards, and so on. In terms of multiplayer games, an example of a positive feedback loop would be Splatoon, where the team that has more ink in the arena is the one who can move more freely through the space, and thus cover more ground. This means they can also ink more of the space. Positive feedback loops are great to make a player gain the advantage quickly. However, this can be dangerous because they can make the players who aren't as skilled or good feel frustrated at the game because they can win. For this reason, games with positive loops can end very quickly and abruptly, since the people that are winning get rewarded and thus become better. Negative feedback loops, on the other hand, are systems that balance out positives and negatives. One example of this is the game of football. When a team scores a touchdown or a field goal, the other team gets a chance to get an offense and try to score a touchdown or a field goal. This prevents the other team that scored first to keep scoring and scoring endlessly. If this happens, they will make the other team feel like there is no point in playing, because they will never catch up. One example for a single player game would be Resident Evil 4 difficulty system. In that game, if you did really well and didn't die, the game's enemies will get harder. However, if you died a lot, then the game's enemies will become easier to help you get through it. In terms of multiplayer games, the best example of negative feedback loops is Mario Kart. In that game, when you're doing really well and are in first place, most of the time you get bananas or green shells as your items, which, let's be honest, are really weak and almost useless. However, if you're in last place, you can gain very powerful items like the Thunder, which makes every other player small and slower, or even the blue shell, which directly hits whoever is in first place, or turn into a bullet to try and help you advance your position in the game. This makes this game more about luck than about skill. Not all games have feedback loops, and some of them use feedback loops in some systems but not in others. For example, in a fighting game like Mortal Kombat, if a player wins round 1, there isn't any advantage or boost that they get from that, and thus, round 2 has both players with the same advantage. The job of the game designer is to juggle these feedback loops in the game in order to create a specific experience that is desired. For example, if a designer puts too many positive feedback loops in the game experience, the game might become too unbalanced. Imagine if in chess, every time a player takes another player's piece, they had another turn. It would reinforce that because the player did good by taking that piece, then they can take another turn, which would exponentially increase that player's chances of winning, making the game unbalanced and even harder for the other player. On the contrary, if the designer ends up using a lot of negative feedback loops in the game, then it can feel like it is dragging, and players might lose interest. This happens a lot in games like Mario Party, in which a player might have a commanding lead with a lot of stars, but then another player steals those stars. In that game, the player who has the lead is changing essentially by the minute, and it consequently feels like there's no progress, making it feel long and sometimes unfair if your stars are taken from you. Negative feedback loops are great when you want a game that is more balanced, as they allow for players from all skill sets to potentially gain an advantage over other players. Negative feedback loops look like this. In this graph, we can see how if A and B are playing a game, the game starts balanced and stays balanced throughout, making it overly long and boring. This happens because there are too many negative feedback loops. Positive feedback loops, on the other hand, look like this. In this graph, we can see how if A and B are playing a game, the game starts balanced at first, but the advantage quickly goes to player A. This happens when there is too much positive feedback. What we really want is a graph that looks like this, which starts out balanced and over time allows for one player to take the lead and eventually win. This is when both positive and negative feedback loops are used properly. Keep in mind that the game you design might need to lead more towards positive or negative feedback, depending on the player experience you have designed. But what feedback loop should you use? Well, I think that obviously depends on your game and what experiential goals you have set for it. However, I think that the best games are those that combine positive loops with negative loops. This results in a game that starts balanced, but as the game goes on, there is one player who rises and ends up being the winner. That allows for the game to not only feel somewhat balanced, but also not too long that they become boring. What I would advise for anyone interested in this to do is to take their favorite game and start studying it and see what positive and negative feedback loops there are and why they are designed that way. I think that by doing this exercise, you will get a better idea of what can work for your game or why use a negative or a positive feedback loop for a specific situation. Doing this will also allow you to improve as a game designer in many ways. Finally, one book that I recommend that talks more specifically about systems and feedback loops is called Thinking in Systems by Donella Meadows. If you read it, let me know if you liked it. I think it is a great book that uses everyday examples that anyone can understand. And that's it, you guys. Thank you so much for watching. What other videos would you like to see from this channel? Please let me know in the comment section below. Also, if you like this video, please hit the like button and share it with your friends. See you next time!